talk is divided into two halves. I'm going to start off with a kind of preamble, and then in the second half, move on to my case study, which is about landfills. So ignore the slide for the time being. Okay, well, the rural seems to be defined in relation to its opposite. I like the idea of the shadow place that Sarah mentioned. And it seems to me this is a relationship of inside and outside. So the urban, our idea of the urban is enclosed and surrounded by the rural. Hence the corresponding idea that the urban is central and the rural is marginal or peripheral. And this is surely a variant, as I think Sarah hinted, of the nature-culture opposition which Latour and others have identified as right at the heart of the sensibilities and the rationales, not only of Western peoples, but also of the modern. The city is taken as a cultural place, a cultural centre, and the rural countryside is taken to correspond more to nature. But of course, this is far too simplistic. And there are many contradictions in all this. And one of them is the idea of cultivated land. Now, I take cultivated to mean cultured. These are agricultural terms, and indeed, agriculture has culture within its very name itself. It's not agri-nature, but agriculture. And it's certainly true that in terms of the ground itself, in terms of the soil or the land, this is much more worked, much more cultivated, more cultured in the countryside than it is in the town or the city, especially in the industrialized agricultural regimes which have held sway, certainly in Britain, from the 19th century onwards. Indeed, the ground is cultivated, you know, over and over again, intensively, rhythmically, in line with the seasons, yes, but also in keeping with the demands of production and the political economy. Well, my approach here will be to try and undermine the rural and the urban through taking a stratigraphic perspective. I think stratigraphy can add a lot to this discussion. Many discussions about land use are very two-dimensional, they're very flat, they concentrate on surface phenomena. And I want to add that missing dimension of depth. And of course, with the depths of stratigraphy goes that fourth dimension of time as well. And we could perhaps start by asking, is there a characteristic stratigraphic signal that we can take as being rural as opposed to urban? And it occurs to me that there is. The other day, I was talking to a fellow archaeologist out in the field who said that he didn't do urban at all. He only did rural stratigraphy, a rural archaeology. And that reminded me that I used to be like that too. I kind of learnt the craft of digging on rural sites. And then where the stratigraphy is only 1 or 2 meters deep, and then I got the shock of my life when in the 1980s I went and worked for the Museum of London on the Royal Mint site, and where we were breaking through concrete at the surface, and we had to go through the brick. We were using pneumatic drills to do that. Then we had to get through the Victorian brick cellar. And only then did we reach that rich medieval archaeology beneath. And of course beneath that is the Roman stratigraphy. So we had a total depth of stratigraphy of maybe about 7 or 8 meters. In places it was much steeper. So the rural-urban dichotomy is embedded in archaeological thought and perception. It's not just in geography and landscape ecology. We associate the urban with greater depths and arguably greater complexity of stratigraphic patterning. Now, features on rural sites, it's interesting the way they tend to be bounded and surrounded by what we call the natural. Whereas on urban sites, it's actually the other way around. So that you tend to get natural processes or natural features, but they're very much within the larger accumulations of occupation debris or cultural materials. So this relation of inside-outside can kind of be inverted and turned inside-out. But because it's so deeply rooted in our perception, our practices, it's actually quite difficult not to see things this way. But surely there are other ways of seeing things, apart from through the lens of the rural-urban opposition. So the idea is to complicate and trouble these deeply rooted assumptions and category distinctions between the rural and the urban. And of course, really, the two kinds of evidence are intermeshed. And we can find the rural in the urban, we can find the urban in the rural. They're a hybrid rural-urban entities. And this can be demonstrated stratigraphically. And that's what I'm going to try and do with my case study, which is looking at landfills in South Bedfordshire. So I'm going to move on to the slide. And what you see is a rural landscape. If you drove south from Bedfordshire towards the M1, on the A421, you'd drive through this landscape of really low hills. But this is actually a very flat vale. This is the Vale of Marston. There never used to be hills here. But even so, even though they've kind of disappeared, nobody really notices them or thinks they're unremarkable. And even archaeologists will drive past and be surprised when I tell them what they actually are. But actually, this is one of the most extraordinary, to me, it's one of the most extraordinary landscapes in the world. Try this one. Nope, it's not.
Just try that. It's not stuck. Yeah.
Sorry. No, that's fine. As you kind of zoom in to look closer at these hills, you see there's something slightly odd about them. They're kind of like a shabby Teletubby land, if you like. And they have these vents sticking up. These are vents for methane. Indicating that the hills are in a kind of gaseous interchange with the atmosphere. I just wanted to emphasize the rurality of the scene by using these sheep here. So this was once an industrial landscape. And what you see here is Stewart B. Pitt, which was for the extraction of clay, mainly for building the city, and especially city suburbs. And I can say with some confidence that possibly Paul's house was built of material which came from this pit or a pit nearby. The company that did the clay extraction was called London Brick, which gives some hint as to where the material was going to. So this is a kind of trace fossil of the city, if you like. It's in a rural area, but it's the void from which the material for building the city came from. This, in my eyes, is an archaeological feature. It's big, but it's essentially the same as any other pit or postcard. It has a cut, it has fills, and you could use the Harris matrix. You could scale the matrix up in order to record and understand its stratigraphy. It's one of a series or chain of pits which follow the band of Oxford clay through central England up to Peterborough. Some have been filled with water, and those that are filled with water are used as recreational lakes. Others are filled with landfill, and here we see the first stages of that landfill process. This is Brogborough Pit, a few miles from Stewartby, and what's being dumped here is mostly household rubbish. But as you can see, a massive urban deposit is beginning to be formed. And what we're actually seeing is a stratigraphic layer or series of layers in the process of formation. In this slide, the same pit, Brogborough Pit, is half full. And this is called a compactor. Its purpose is to compact the material down. When I say half full, there's probably about 20 or 30 metres of landfill beneath this compactor at this moment in time. And you can see flying around it lots of seagulls who are attracted to this process. And they're there for the rotting food waste. So things like Kentucky Fried Chicken, with the packaging sometimes, is very popular. And, okay, this is a geological section drawn through that pit. And gives you some idea of the scale. It's about 1 kilometre across. And 50 metres deep up to the old ground surface, but they didn't actually stop dumping when they reached the ground surface. They carried on to make the hill, which will flatten out a bit in time. Now, within that larger deposit of essentially urban rubbish, the rubbish is coming from many of the same houses that the Brits went to build. It's coming from the city, from London and other cities. But within that, there are kind of special deposits. And some of those special deposits are from the countryside. I mentioned chickens a bit earlier. And these, of course, are produced in factories or chicken sheds, which are nearly always out in the countryside. You hardly ever get chicken sheds in the city itself. Partly because they're smelly. Now, for the most part, the bio waste from those chicken factories ends up being incinerated or composted. But there are certain periodic events, maybe occurring every 7 years or so, when these catastrophic events happen, which effectively mean that normal protocols for getting rid of waste are relaxed, and the waste gets buried in landfill. So for example, where you have outbreaks of avian flu, whole factories full of poultry Thank you. Have to be euthanized. It's terrible, and I really hope this doesn't upset anybody. As it, indeed, it upset me when I found out about it, and it's effectively turned me from a meat eater into a vegetarian. But when these outbreaks of avian flu happen, birds are euthanized by one of the ways of doing it is with firefighting foam. So a whole factory floor would be, these birds would be killed. And they are put into dumper trucks lined with plastic. And they're taken to landfill dumps. So this is an example here of maybe thousands of poultry carcasses going into landfill. This is in Virginia in 2002, but there have been other avian flu outbreaks since then. And effectively what they do is they, the landfill is in the process of being deposited, but they dig a trench into that household rubbish, deposit the poultry carcasses into the trench, and they deposit it intact, so you can see the whole dump truck load full goes into the trench, and then they cover it over again with the household rubbish. So effectively you have that rural deposit full of these chicken carcasses, which will have an incredible potential for survival. Because although landfills, there is some decomposition in the first 15 or 20 years, that very quickly dies off. And these become kind of inert deposits. They're capped and lined these days. And they tend to be removed from the processes going on in the outside world. And in Rathjay's excellent study of landfills, archaeology of landfills, he pointed out that they're really structures for the mummification of deposits. So even things like paper will last an incredibly long time in landfills. Now, of course, landfills will be subject to geological process, to inundation, and also to human processes, such as landfill mining. But on the other hand, we know that landfills, thanks, survive for that there are Neolithic landfills around tell sites in the Fertile Crescent, which have survived perfectly okay for 8,000 years or several thousand years. So there's quite good potential for survival. And if you look at this in section or profile view, what you actually have is, in this urban context, this urban area of Bedford, you have this giant deposit of urban household rubbish. But within that, you have these special deposits of from the industrialized rural landscape. And on quite a big scale, this is just a schematic drawing. So I think this gives us a cue, if you like, instead of dividing the world just into urban and rural, we should see both of these as intermeshed components of a greater entity, something like the technosphere, which you might be familiar with that concept. The technosphere would include both rural and urban parts, because they're very much intermeshed as part of the same entity. Okay, thank you very much. Thanks.